Hi, I'm Vivian Guzman. My guest today on Dishing It is former CEO of Guerrilla Marketing. He sold 28 million books in 62 different languages. Yes, he's a marketing genius. When he's not appearing on TV as a celebrated publisher and entrepreneur, he's icon building at top talent, repping the who's who in Hollywood. I'm excited to make some extra special French toast with David Fagan and Isabel, his wife, and unpack their latest joint masterpiece called Becoming Significant, which is sure to become his, their sixth number one best-selling book. Welcome to Dishing It.
I'm Vivian Guzman. Life hasn't always been easy. I have felt alone, displaced, like an outsider. The world needs a place of belonging, which is why I created Dishing It.
Cheers.
Cheers!
On Dishing It, I cook foods from around the world. My guests share their stories, and we inspire the world.
The reason I save marriages past, present, and future is because I want it to be that lovely, cute 80-year-old couple that you see still holding hands is the norm.
Welcome to Dishing It.
Hi, David and Isabel. Welcome to Dishing It.
Hey!
And you're making
French toast. This is the first thing I learned how to make from my mother. I was probably 5-6 years old. I was really young.
That's so cute. Oh my goodness. Oh, I see your book, Becoming Significant. Both your book.
Yes, me and Isabel wrote this book over the last year, and it was kind of a passion project of ours. We had a lot of fun just putting together and designing it. And a lot of work went into this. It's a very different kind of book.
I can't wait to talk about it, but I'm starving. Everything looks so good. I'm ready to rock and roll. Show me, what do I do first?
We've already got our eggs cracked here and in the bowl, ready to go. Okay, so we're gonna get to add in the almond milk. So I'll have Isabel add in our half cup of almond milk. All right, we're gonna have Isabel whisk away. I've got a professional whisker here.
I'm following, I'm trying to keep up.
We're doing that with a fork. You're professional with your whisker there. Okay, I think we got it, ladies. We got it. And the winner is, too close to call. I'm smart enough not to say who won. Okay, so next thing we wanna do is get the pan ready. So we've got a full-on griddle we like. We're professional when it comes to our breakfasts here. Sometimes I will literally cook bacon on the griddle first to grease the pan. Today we're gonna use 100% butter.
I kind of went and I greased some bacon and I got a cast iron pan. So I got some bacon fat, so I'm going with the fat today.
That is a great way to go, All right, so we're now ready to throw some French toast on here. So Isabel's gonna start dipping and tossing.
I was wondering, do you add the cinnamon and a little bit of nutmeg into the egg batter, or do you do that later?
No, I always like to do it afterwards. I get it more proportionally the way that I like it. So when you get ready to take that bite, my mouth's watering saying this right now. When you get ready to take that bite, you see the cinnamon, you see maybe some walnuts.
I'm digging it.
So another thing that we'll put on top of our French toast sometime is a little bit of crushed oat cereal. It has a little bit of nut in there, a little bit of cereal, and it gives it this real crispy layer across the top of our French toast. So Isabel's gonna put some of the walnuts on some of them and a little bit of the crushed oat cereal on some of them.
I like it.
Here's what this looks like.
Yours looks amazing. Look at mine. I got brioche bread because I couldn't find your fabulous Texas bread or the Sara Lee.
Oh, brioche bread is also really good bread for you. I like it. All right, we're starting to flip ours. But this is one of my family's favorites, is the French toast. And they'll make their orders. Dad, no walnuts on mine. Dad, do the cereal on mine.
This is great. So, how many children do you have?
I have 8 children.
Fun house.
So me and my first wife have had 8 children. Oldest is 23, youngest is 9. I have 3 girls in a row, then 4 boys in a row, and then a girl at the end. And me and Isabel got married here a few years ago, and my kids absolutely love and adore her. She loves playing bonus mom, and because we love to cook and bake, it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun on the weekends. I don't know how many times, you know, especially the youngest, Shelby, our girl at 9, you know, jumps in the kitchen with Isabel, and they just kind of go crazy.
So they look like they're ready.
Yes, yeah. They are. They're done. They're ready to go.
Mm-mm-mm. That looks so good.
We're getting out a third plate for you, Vivian.
I love it.
Yeah, we can add more stuff to the top.
Yeah.
We also have strawberries here. So what I like to do is I put a little syrup on first. And now I'll go ahead and throw us some strawberries on there. Go ahead and spread those out nice and neat and pretty. So there you go.
Looks beautiful. Are you ready?
I'm ready, let's see it. Nice. Look at you. You're an overachiever. And then here's what me and Isabel do. Cheers. And then sometimes we'll eat off the same plate, and then sometimes I'll try to stop her with her bite to keep it interesting. And
oh my God, that looks so good.
Let me just
take one of your strawberries then.
Over there. All right, fine. Let me get a bite out of mine first.
It's gotta take a bite when it's fresh and hot.
Absolutely.
Moment of truth. Moment of truth.
I love the crunch that I can feel coming out of the French toast, and I don't think that anywhere that I go, they never really do that. Firm, yet soft and moist. It's soaked up everything, so there's the creaminess from the butter and the sweetness from the maple, and that beautiful crunch that comes, and then every now and then I feel that cinnamon pop.
So, something I like to do as well when I'm eating French toast is I'll get a nice sized bite of French toast and a nice slice of strawberry, so you have that extra sweetness from it coming into all those yummy ingredients with the crunchy walnuts and the nice warm French toast. It all just tastes absolutely amazing.
I think you're describing the perfect bite.
Yeah, I think
so,
I am.
So how about we go somewhere else and finish eating, unpack, and talk about becoming significant?
Yeah, it sounds great.
So David and Isabel, I'm so happy that you're here. I'm so happy that I'm beautifully fed by your French toast. And now I want to talk about becoming significant. But before I do, I'd like to know how you both met.
Well, we actually met on the set of my California cable TV show called The Hollywood Entrepreneur. So at the time she was working on set doing like makeup and hosting. And so the first time I ever saw her, she was actually doing my makeup before the show. So
oh
I sat
God.
There and stared at her neck for about 4 or 5 minutes as she did my, I think this is a nice neck. This is a good looking neck. And so that was my first up close and personal exposure. But we didn't actually date until a year or two later on after first meeting and kind of working together in our different businesses and stuff.
So Isabel, how long were you a makeup artist?
I went to school for about a year to learn cosmetology, to learn makeup. And so I had a couple of gigs where I was working with beauty queens, scholarship queens, helping do out little photo shoots here and there for people who were doing headshots and things like that because they wanted to go into acting. I think the biggest gig that I had as a makeup artist at that time was working with David on the set of The Hollywood Entrepreneur.
And she's being extremely modest here. She's actually one of those pageant winners and won quite a few pageants.
I was just about to say, not just anything, because I did. I Googled a little bit about you, Isabel, and I was like, oh my God, how beautiful. And I saw that you were a pageant queen. That's awesome.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I did pageants for 5 years. The biggest title I got with the correct wording is Miss Teen California Latina in 2013. But at the same time, very few people know this, is that during those 5 years I was doing pageants, I was also doing softball at the same time. I know, so there'd be some days where I would actually have to finish a game, hurry home to get dressed up and cleaned up just to go out to an event wearing my sash and crown.
That's such a good visual. I love that transition. It's like the woman that does everything. That kind of describes you today.
Some of our first dates, Vivian, were actually in acting class.
I love the romance. I love the...
It's all an act, Vivian.
Y'all work together, so it's not an act. You also work at Joint Ventures, and she's also the editor-in-chief of Top Talent Magazine.
Top Talent Magazine is definitely a huge passion project of mine. I've always loved just seeing people on the cover being celebrated for their accomplishments and being able to utilize that platform to really be able to emphasize their message and be able to touch more people than they may have not been able to.
Give me the scoop, David. Tell me about all the Hollywood fabulous people that you represent at Top Talent.
No, that's a good question about working with the celebrities, because it is a little bit of a different route. You know, basically I went and bought and took over and made a seven-figure deal to buy an up and running publicity company in Beverly Hills. And we kind of merged. You know, my existing marketing and management company came together with their publicity arm.
And what I love about your story is that you went from paperboy to high school dropout, fast forward to guerrilla marketing, owning the PR firm, repping the who's who in Hollywood, continuing to keep stacking all of your success. So how do you do that?
Well, you just spanned about 40 years. So, you know, a 40-year overnight success, I guess. I mean, we skipped a lot of things, which we have to. We don't have enough time to go through all that. No, I think a big part of it is surrounding yourself with really good people. You know, we want lifters, not leaners. You know, we want to surround ourselves with people that lift us up and help us become the best version of ourselves. And in life, I've had some amazing mentors. I have ridden the coattails of some pretty amazing people, for sure.
When did you make it? When did you just realize, like, wow, everything my mentors taught me translates into this?
Success comes in increments, right? There is no big break. I think the big break is kind of a myth. I definitely think there are points in my life that were bigger than maybe others. Moving to California, being on stage, writing my first book, first couple times I was on Fox News, being on the Today Show. But yeah, I think success comes in increments. And the idea is, you know, what's the power play? What can you do in the next 4 to 6 weeks to make you money or get you results? And that's kind of what I coach other people to do. Look for the power play. Look for the accomplishment that if you achieved it, everything in your life gets a little bit easier. Even Isabel. If I could just get Isabel to marry me, life would just get easier.
So what does success mean to you now? And also for you, Isabel.
I'll let you take that one. What does success mean to you now?
Success to me means that I'm able to be able to provide for my family in a way that I've always wanted to be able to. Growing up, I grew up in a very small family, but we were always well taken care of. And now that I've married David, I'm in a much larger family. And for me, success is being able to, you know, if they call me and they need some help, I have the means or the ability to be able to help them.
I think that's beautiful. For me, success has, you know, I still want the Golden Star, right? Still chasing my dad one day, proud from heaven, saying, "You did it, kid."
And success, the idea of it, the goal of it changes as you evolve in your life. I mean, for 16-year-old Isabel, she wanted to be able to have a house that had more than 3 bedrooms in it. And I've now achieved that goal. But it's consistently just changed and evolved as we experience different things. And whereas we thought success would be 5 years ago, 10 years ago, is different than how we are now. And I think that's something that more and more people are truly realizing as well.
Well, and that's kind of the book Becoming Significant. That's kind of the idea behind it, is many times we put out a goal, which is perfect. You should have goals. But a lot of times we'll achieve those goals, and sometimes we realize that that goal maybe wasn't as fulfilling as we thought it was going to be. And we realize that there really is more of an inner game, right? There's more of an internal thing. And there is a different measurement and a different way, and for that matter, multiple ways, to really feel a sense of fulfillment. And what is a life of significance? What does it mean to be significant? And so we just started having these conversations about, you know, what that looked like. And instead of accidentally winding up in these places, kind of analyzing, well, how did we get here? And how did we do this? well, let's not do that on accident. Let's reinvent that and do that on purpose.
Can you give me an example? Is it like, I don't want to go clubbing anymore?
No, I think that, look, we all grow up with what I would call limiting beliefs. And so even at a very young age, I was working and I was making money. And something that my dad would tell me, which was very well intentioned, was, hey, you shouldn't spend your money on things that you don't have anything to show for it, right? So I grew up thinking, as I spend my money, I need to have something physical to show for it, right? So as time went on, I would think more about things that I would physically have, not the experience, but physical things. And so, you know, it wasn't until much later on in my life that memories and experiences had a lot more value to me. And it was a very innocent limiting belief that I had. But, you know, I closed down my Beverly Hills office, you know, around 2015, and I bought a sailboat, and I was like, why am I waiting to retirement to buy this dream and to have these experiences, right? I wanna do this now, I wanna do it with my kids now. You know, so that's a good example of, you know, maybe it's not the best investment per se, but what are we waiting for in life, right? What are we waiting on? What are our limiting beliefs that are forcing us to say, well, I've gotta wait till retirement, or I gotta wait until I have this certain amount of money, or I gotta wait for permission, or I gotta wait for the perfect time. And so I think for a lot of people, we just want to stop waiting and start, you know, doing.
Let me see the book. Let me see it. Let me see it. I just think it's gorgeous. Of course, I read it digitally and you just got it now. I love that it is, like you said, it's skimmable. I love that every time that I open it and I flip, there's a beautiful message or something that, you know, hits home. Knowing when to quit is so important. And I think I'm just like learning that. I'm very excitable and I wanna do everything. I wanna please everyone. I wanna jump on every project. And then at the cost of my health, I'll get it done. I just know that if I'm gonna do something, I need to say no to something. And I thought that that was just such an important highlight that you put in the book.
When you're looking to take on new projects, to develop a new product, try to go out to other people's events, it all takes time and it all takes a piece of you and part of who you are. And so you kind of have to look at what's on your plate, essentially, what it is that you have already going on in your life, and saying, what am I going to quit? Am I going to spend less time with my kids? Am I going to sleep less? So that's the whole point of quitting, is the secret art of winning, but also finishing is happiness. They're both polar opposites, but in finishing what you've already started, you want to find that self of accomplishment. But if you're giving up all of yourself into everything, you're gonna finish nothing. Oh,
that's just gold right there, in my opinion. Thank you. That hit me, especially because I've been now saying a little bit more no to different projects so that I could focus on what is important to me, like what fills my heart. And I think that, I guess what I love about the book as well is it's about character building, right? And how you can live your best life with meaning and purpose. And I love that it's a dictionary. And I love that you have synonyms. And I want to know why you use that. And I want to let you know why I loved it. But why did you use the synonyms?
I'm big on the emotional triggers of things. And it's interesting, when we see a definition, and there's actually one on this page here, but when we see a definition, you don't read it, you experience it. We took a lot of the key words that we really feel like unlock things, like when you know what the real meaning of that word is and how we're intending, because some words have multiple meanings. But when people experience those words, it really takes you to someplace new.
Wow, that's beautiful. So tell me about the illustrations.
So, you know, there's probably over 100 different images in here that me and Isabel went through and handpicked out, and some we even created. And we really designed it too. And this is something Isabel helped a lot with, is when you open it up, it's always meant to be experienced left and right. Like, this is not its own thing and this is its own thing. This always goes together.
Ah, I love that. You just landed on a perfect day. So tell me, what's a perfect day for you?
The key to it is peace of mind. And a lot of times we're not at peace with ourselves because we have regrets, right? And so getting rid of some of those regrets or accepting things for the way that they are is kind of key to it. Let me read one thing right out of the book.
Yes, please.
And so this is kind of one of my quotes in the book, but it just says, "A perfect day is when I fulfilled my routines, checked off my lists, exercised, ate well, slept well, and lived well. These perfect days are my best days, but they don't happen every day. Still, I'm always looking for clearer ways to design the perfect day, as well as more effective ways to execute the perfect day. And although I chase perfection, I am content with progress."
It's true, because sometimes I feel like, you know, you get caught up in beating yourself up for not accomplishing certain things, but even just breaking the habit of not beating yourself up for not accomplishing those things is progress. Everything that you're saying, I'm like, yes, yes, yes. Having the two of you together for me is my favorite, because I love seeing the celebration of love. I love that you both dared to take a chance in the pursuit of your dreams, that you celebrate love, diversity, and inclusion, that you fit as leaders 50 billion times over what Dishonit is in spirit and in mission. So I'm so grateful to have the two of you here today on Dishonit, and I'm so honored that you gave me all of your time today and that you made me the most delicious French toast, which I will now make forever. And I can't wait to make that for my family. So thank you for all of the gifts that you've given me here today. And I consider you both my friends, and I consider you mentors. So thank you. So
thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.